That button. Let's go.
Okay.
May the Lord be with you. A few announcements for us this morning. We've got AA Tuesday evening at 8, youth group Wednesday evening at 6, and we're planning on going caroling, so if you hear some racket outside your house as you live here in town, it's hopefully just us trying to sing. And then Thursday evening is the Christmas Eve service. We'll be starting at 7 o'clock. And it should be a wonderful evening of music and reflections on the birth of Jesus. This year's Christmas offering, you know, that special envelope that's in your offering boxes, will be once again shared between the McClure Village Damascus Township Food Pantry and the West Ohio Conference Benevolence's portion of our apportionments. Are there any announcements I'm forgetting this morning?
Thank you.
Thank you. McClureUMC2015, and join me in the prayer for Advent. Merciful God, you sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way of our salvation. Give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may celebrate aright the commemoration of the Nativity and may await with joy the coming in glory of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. He lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Okay, if you would turn to 205, the responsive reading, Candle of Light and Darkness. We look for light, but find darkness. For brightness, but walk in gloom. We grope like those who have no eyes. We stumble at noon as in the twilight. If I say, let only darkness cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. Blessed be your name, O God, forever. You reveal deep and mysterious things. You are light, and in you is no darkness. Our darkness is passing away, and already the true light is shining.
If you would, let us turn to the backs of our bulletins to our prayer list. Would there be updates on ones that are on the prayer list or joys or concerns that we would like to share this morning?
Pastor, I have a past concern but joy that goes with it. Jessica had gotten really sick a couple days ago, and through motherly advice, we got her taken over to the hospital where they kept her. She had walking pneumonia, and her sugar levels were extremely high, which threw her kidneys into what they classify dry kidneys. But overnight, they pumped her full of meds and everything else, and I think truly, deep prayer from everyone brought her back to being better, and they let her come home, and she's right back at it. She doesn't know the word rest. So.
Well, you had your rest while you were in the hospital, right? Yes.
So I'm very joyful. I'm very thankful for prayer warriors out there, and God's taking care of her really well.
Well, we're really glad you're with us this morning, Jessica. We hope everything gets all straightened out. You continue to keep feeling better and continuing, being smiling and being happy. That's wonderful. Yes. Could there be any others this morning? Oh, sorry. Sometimes you got to yell at me from this side. You might peripheral just go, bam! If you would, please keep him in your prayers that the healing will go well, because sometimes he's had some issues with his healing on this. So pray that things will go well for Al. Would there be any others this morning? Okay, well, if not, let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, for your sunshine, for the coolness that allows us to know that winter's on its way and that your seasons are still moving. We thank you, Lord, for all the things we felt as we gathered together this morning, for the smiles on our faces, for the joy we felt as we saw each other. We give you thanks and praise. We ask, Lord, that you will be with us this day, that you will hear our prayers, that you will take care of these ones that are on our hearts. We place them in your hands, and we ask, Lord, that you will move in your mighty and amazing ways. That you will just allow us to see you move, that we will see things happen. and we will continue to give you the praise for all that you do. We thank you, Lord, for having been with Jessica. We ask that you will continue to be with her. We ask that you will continue to keep things balanced for her and help her get back to healthy and allow all things to go well so that she'll be able to keep doing all the things that she feels she needs to do. Continue to watch over her and care for her and help the doctors and nurses to do all those things so that she will continue to be better. We also bring out to you this morning, Lord, and we thank you for all the ways you've been with him through all the things done. And we know, Lord, that you will be with him once again as his foot is going through things Wednesday. We ask, Lord, that you will be with him, that you will help the doctors and nurses to do the things that will help him to heal and recover, and that, Lord, you will just allow all things to go well. We thank you, Lord. We pray for these others who are on our list and the others who are on our hearts, Lord. We just ask that you will be with them, that you will move, that you will do your things, and we will give you praise. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to keep your peace, your safety, and your security upon this land. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to help us to be your people, and that you will continue to hear our voice. We ask, Lord, that you will speak to our leaders, that you will help them to speak to you, and that you will help them to make decisions that are good for all of us and pleasing to you. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to watch over those who take care of us and those who protect us. We especially ask, Lord, that you will be with those who are in the military, that you will watch over them and care for them, and that you will bring them safely home to us. We ask, Lord, that you will be with those who do not come home. We ask, Lord, for those who are injured. We ask that you will give your healing both in body and in spirit. And for those, Lord, who do not come home, we ask that you will care for them by pouring your love, your peace, and your grace out upon their families. That you will help them to know that they and their loved ones are in your hands. We thank you, Lord. We also pray and ask that you will watch over our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren, and that you will go with them all the places that they go, and that you will help them to feel your love. And we thank you, Lord, for those who are in the nursing homes. Be with them, watch over them, and care for them. Make their days good and surround them in your love. Bless those who care for them and watch over them and allow their days to be good and joy to fill the halls. We thank you, Lord. We pray all these things in your Son Jesus' holy name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Tristan, would you do me a favor? Would you go get your sister and anybody else that's in the nursery? Think you can do that for me? You're even allowed to run. Awesome. And when you come back with your sister, just come straight up front. Would the other kids that are here with us today come up front here? Those of you who are young at heart, if you want to come up here today, you can also. Gosh, he must not have ran. Oh, we have a couple young at hearts coming up. Excellent. Excellent. So how are you guys today? Good? You guys know what these things are?
We're doing it.
What, Tristan, doesn't she believe you? Yep, come on up here. What, she didn't believe you? how are you today? Good? Do you guys know what these things are?
Candy.
Candy canes. Do you know where candy canes came from?
No.
Yeah. Don't open them yet. Candy canes did not come from Santa Claus.
I don't like
this. Well, you can have it anyway, and you can give it to someone who does, okay? See, that's sometimes about a gift that we get. Sometimes it's actually a gift to give to someone else. There you go. So candy canes do not come from Santa Claus. Candy canes are actually a way to share the gospel message. Did you know that they have been around since 1880? That's not really a long time ago, you know? You did. Excellent. Did you know that this church has been around longer than candy canes?
No.
I know. That's a scary thought, isn't it? That means God has been doing things here before candy canes. That's pretty amazing. Well, candy canes were introduced in the late 1880s. And they actually supposedly were made for the first time by a candy maker in Indiana. How many stripes are on it?
One.
No. Now there's one big thick stripe, right? And it just wraps around everything. And then there's a paler stripe, isn't there? And how many stripes are in it? Three. Okay, well, the hardness of this candy, because it's hard, right? You know, unless you smack it on something, don't smack it on anything, okay, because then it'll break, okay? But the hardness of it is to represent the rock, okay? The hardness of it is to represent, actually, the rock, the church, the foundation of Christianity, okay? And then we find the twist. The white stripes of the candy cane, the white in it, I guess those are actually stripes. Do they look like stripes?
No.
But they're actually supposed to be stripes. Do you know what they represent? Any ideas? Okay. Well, the white represents the purity of Jesus. If the white part of the candy cane was all filled with black specks, we'd be wondering, wouldn't we? Right? But no, it's a really pure white color, isn't it? So it reminds us of the purity of Christ. The small red stripes, the three of them, actually reminds us of the price Jesus paid for us at Easter. They stand for the wounds that he received from the whip. And then the large red stripes stand for the blood that Jesus shed. Because blood is bright and it's strong and it really shows up. Anytime you've gotten it on your clothes, your mom's had to work real hard to get it out, hadn't she? And sometimes it doesn't come out, does it? No. So the shape of the candy cane, you think that has anything special? What? Okay. What if you look at it like this? Okay, or like this? Which is it? A J for Jesus, yes. One way is a J. I gotta think of which way it needs to be pointed towards you so you see it as a J.
And it even looks like a book.
And it looks like a book, but we'll talk about that part in a minute. Now what is it this way? A shepherd's staff. And who's the good shepherd? How about Jesus? J, Jesus, the good shepherd. Okay, because he comes for his lost sheep, us, remember? Okay, and what's it with the other way? A hook? It can be a hook, too. But, oh, goodness, I am so glad you misunderstood. It can be a hook, too, because whenever you give this to someone, it gives you a chance to tell them the story. And they get a chance to think about the story and that kind of stuff. Now, I don't want you guys, unless you really know someone that loves these more than you, I don't want you to give these big ones away. Okay? But I do have enough for you guys to give. everybody here today some candy canes. Will you guys do that for me?
Yep.
And if you don't like them, take them and share them with someone who does. Okay? All right. Why don't you guys set yours down for a minute? Just set them up here. That way they won't get stepped on. Okay? Go find some people. Go find some people. It's okay. I'll pick them up. Let her throw people. Find some people. I'll pick them up. Find some people. Find some people. Find some people. Find some people. Just they didn't think about people sitting out here. Did I give you guys enough? People need more? You got a couple more? Everybody got one? Everybody remember everybody all the way in the back? Well, ask them. If you have it down, ask. Okay, who's been missed? I know some people have been missed. Yeah, there's a couple over here that's been missed. Anybody got any left out? You don't get it. You don't have any left. Come and get some. I know there's a couple still out there. Find them. Find them. Everybody should have big smiles on their faces because they already have candy canes. And if anybody's not smiling, give them another one until they are smiling. And whenever we think about Jesus, he's supposed to inspire us to remember what he's done, which should make us smile. You can have that one too. Okay, what? Oh, okay. 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 Okay, so you guys got one. Everybody's got one, and everybody's got a smile now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's what we're looking for. Okay. Well, guys, go ahead, stick them in here. And make sure you guys get your candy cane. Make sure you get your candy cane. That one right by your hand. Right there. Perfect. Yep. Perfect. Perfect. Everybody got it? Yes, you may go back. And Kristen, would you feel like taking your sister back? Is there an adult left down here? Okay, you didn't come up, Sharon. Okay, I wanted to make sure you guys did. You got your candy cane. Okay.
We don't tell you the way.
Something about that name.
Okay, that's right.
verses 1 through 17. It's Nathan's message to David. King David was settled in his palace, and the Lord kept him safe from all his enemies. Then the king said to the prophet Nathan, "Here I am, living in a house built of cedar, but God's covenant box is kept in a tent." Nathan answered, "Do whatever you have in mind, because the Lord is with you." But that night, the Lord said to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David that I say to him, 'You are not the one to build a temple for me to live in.' From the time I rescued the people of Israel from Egypt until now, I have never lived in a temple. I have traveled around living in a tent. In all my traveling with the people of Israel, I never asked any of the leaders that I appointed why they had not built me a temple made of cedar. So tell my servant David that I, the Lord Almighty, say to him, 'I took you from looking after sheep in the fields and made you the ruler of my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have defeated all your enemies as you advanced. I will make you as famous as the greatest leaders in the world. I have chosen a place for my people Israel and have settled them there, where they will live without being oppressed anymore. Ever since they entered this land, they have been attacked by violent people, but this will not happen again. I promise to keep you safe from all your enemies and to give you descendants. When you die and are buried with your ancestors, I will make one of your sons king and will keep his kingdom strong. He will be the one to build a temple for me, and I will make sure that his dynasty continues forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him as a father punishes his son. But I will not withdraw my support from him as I did from Saul, whom I removed so that you could be king. You will always have descendants, and I will make your kingdom last forever. Your dynasty will never end." Nathan told David everything that God had revealed to him. Thus ends the reading of the word.
Our New Testament reading comes to us from the book of Matthew, from the first chapter, verses 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you will name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. Lord, bless these your holy words, and we who hear them. Joseph doesn't make a lot of appearances in Jesus' story. He doesn't make a lot of appearances in the Bible, and in fact, after a couple more pages here, and the story of Jesus being in Jerusalem as a 13-year-old, we hear not another thing from Joseph. But here we find a man who God has called and chosen, and not only called and chosen, but called and chosen wisely. Okay? And the reason I say wise is because, well, we've all been called. Right? God has placed a call in each and every one of our lives. It's how we respond to Him is what, how deep that call goes. Not all of us are called to be ministers. Not all of us are called to be someone who writes. Not all of us are called to be someone who heals. We're all called by God. What do we do with the call? Sometimes we sit on it, don't we? We allow it to be this gift for salvation, and that is exactly all we do. Let's face it. How many of us would be able to be a Joseph to just accept God's word sent by the angel in a dream? How many of us would just be able to accept it? Look at Zechariah. We talked about him, haven't we? He's the priest. He's the one that should interact with God every day. He's the one that should have got it. He's the one that should have come out of the Holy of Holies, shouting hallelujah and jumping for joy, saying, God says I'm going to have a son, and he's a forerunner for the Christ. And he should have been able to come out of the Holy of Holies and announce it. But he didn't. He couldn't. And he was struck mute until John was born. Well, that's already happened. John has been born. Joseph has found out now that Mary is pregnant. He knows it's not his. And he has a restless night's sleep where an angel comes and visits him. Now the amazing thing about Joseph is not that he's declared righteous. Not that he's declared true. Not that he's this fine, upstanding person. In fact, other than being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, he's not listed as even some of the phrases that describe some of the heroes. And yet, this is the very man that God has chosen to place his son into the hands of. That this would be the man that he would trust to just follow his voice and say, wherever I tell you to go, whatever I tell you to do, just do it. Guys, do we follow anyone that way? Any of us in basic training, did we even follow our sergeants fully that way? We might have pretended to, right? But we didn't follow them to the degree that they were grinning from ear to ear when they looked at us, right? No. Any of you women that have been in the military know the very same thing. You try to do what they say, but you don't do it quick enough. You don't do it fast enough. You don't do it high enough. You don't do it low enough. You don't do it blah, blah, blah enough. You can't do it enough. Find Joseph, this guy who was just told. Him and Mary almost sound like a perfect pair, don't they? Because Mary just said, okay, let it be. Let it be. Joseph requires a lot of faith too, doesn't he? Tons of it. Because let's face it, nobody wants to think that you've been fooled into raising someone else's kid, do they? Not fooled into it. Many will do it. But not being fooled into it. Joseph just took the angel's word, did what he said. It's a hard place for us to be at. It's hard sometimes for us to just trust that God said, I will be with you through this. And know that He will be with us through it. Right? We like to struggle. We like to worry. We like to fret. We like to fear. We like to control the situation. How many people have a designated driver in their family? Not when people drink, but this is who's going to drive because I get behind the wheel of the car when we get in the car. We do, don't we? We do. In most cases, unless you drive by yourself and you're the only person that drives your car, or your special car, or this or that, there is typically one person who drives. I feel very, very, very strange anytime Don drives somewhere. And that's straight out, okay? Not that she's a bad driver. She's not. Okay? She's probably a safer driver than I am in some situations. But there's just something about having your hand on the steering wheel, isn't it? Have you ever driven with someone that's driving or ridden with someone that's driving and they have to look at you when they talk? Okay, yes, there we go. That scares you, doesn't it? Don't you really wish you were driving? Don't you always refuse to look at their face because you wish they'd pay more attention to the road? We love being in control, don't we? How do we become a Joseph that says, that wakes up from a dream and says, yes, Lord. Says, yes, Lord. He had gone to bed the night before, decided he was going to do something completely different. And then in the morning, God had come to him and told him. And he said, yes. It's a hard place to be at, isn't it? I was reading a homily this week from John Chrysostom. He did some writings on the book of Matthew. And he actually started his homily out on these verses with how come we leave here and most of the things that we heard today doesn't stay with us. See, now I want you to remember that he wrote these things 1,500 years ago, okay? So we've been thick as a brick as people for 1,500 or more years, okay? Now he says he knows we're not just going to get it all at once, and that's why we always need to come back and get refreshed and refilled and get new thoughts rolling around up here. But he said, the problem is when we leave this place and we go out into the world, we go back to the world. We don't take this with us. We don't dwell in this any. We don't take some time to draw our family and friends near to discuss what we heard today, to make it internal, to make it a part of us. That's where he started from with this passage. And I can understand it because if it wasn't internalized, if Joseph didn't know that Isaiah had said, the virgin will bear a child, will bear a son, he will save his people. If those words weren't already written in here, how's he going to believe the angel? If those words aren't already a part of what's going on in his mind, how can those things change and make you available for those things and the calls that God has upon our lives? How many of us got tired of hearing Grandma and Grandpa when we were kids talking about what Pastor talked about in church on Sunday at Sunday dinner? Can't we talk about the football games coming up? Talk about what's going to be on A Wonderful World at Disney tonight? Not what they talked about in church, anything but. How many of us actually talk about what we heard, what it meant to us in church on Sunday afternoons after we leave here over summer? The hands become less and less. We can all remember someone who did that, right? That they tried to impart upon us those very same things and those practices. Don't do that. How often do we do that? That's how Joseph was able to just wake up from the dream and go, okay. wasn't filled special with the Spirit? Wasn't in the Holy of Holies? He was in a place where he left himself available for God's call on his life. Now he's going to do some traveling, he's going to do some protecting, and then he's going to totally disappear from the story. We do not know what happened to Joseph. But what we know about Joseph is that he had internalized all the things that God had done in his life around him and in Scripture. And it changed him to be able to answer that call when God places it upon you. The same thing will happen to us. Through prayer, Scripture reading, and talking about what God has done, is doing, and will do, will keep us in that place where we can be more like Joseph, where we can be more like Mary, where we can be able to say, yes, Lord, let it be. Just trust me. Let us pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, we know, Lord, sometimes that's the hard place for us to be. You just trust in you. Because, Lord, that's scary. Because we do like to drive. We like to have control. And trusting in you means that we're going to go where you take us. And in the ways that you take us there. We ask, Lord, that you help us to internalize you, your word, your promises, and your blessings. That as they become a part of us, that they get shared with others. That as they become a part of us, we get closer to you. That we love you more. We see you through those eyes of trust and love. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. If you would, at this time, let us respond with the response of faith with the Apostles' Creed on page 7 in our hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. On the third day he rose, ascended to the dead. Third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This time, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the many ways that you bless us. We thank you for these opportunities to give of ourselves to you and of the blessings that you have poured out upon us. Take us, Lord. Use us. Sanctify us and bless us for your work, for your good, for your pleasures. Do the same with these gifts, tithes, and offerings. Allow us and them to be a blessing to those around us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
If you would please remain standing and open your hymnals to number 206. Join me in singing "I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light," our closing hymn today.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and for all your days.